Eric Fisherwick, the CLSA's head of economic research.
Good morning.
Good morning. Now, China, first of all, triple R rate cut.
Yeah.
Does that surprise you? The FT Lex called it mischievous.
The timing always surprises, though with hindsight it was staged to take the market's attention away from a weak PMI reading. But it's always been likely, relatively quickly, because China needs to free up some bank balance sheet if it is to increase lending. And I think it has to increase its lending quota next year in order to avoid slowing significantly as a result of what's happening in Europe.
Inflation out next week, many saying it's now peaked.
It will be an unproblematic number. It peaked back in August and it's been falling quite significantly since then. Certainly in terms of driving policy, it's yesterday's news.
Now, what is today's news is, of course, the impact on Asia from Europe. Now, you've got this comment looking at research. The ECB is now the only institution that we think can break the vicious circle of Europe's sovereign debt crisis. They have to pump money.
I think they have to. In the minute we started to see markets pushing bund yields higher, it told you that markets didn't think that Europe could achieve a good outcome with its own resources and without using the central bank. So the ECB is now central. Quite frankly, it's the only true Eurozone institution, and it's now time for it to step up to the plate.
Now, have the Germans therefore boxed themselves into a corner by saying no buying of bonds and the EFSF wings have been clipped, if you like?
That might be a bit harsh. I think Germany has been deliberately using market pressure in order to force the periphery of Europe to become more and more willing to impose fiscal austerity. But let's put it like this. If Germany continues to block the ECB buying government debt in Europe, the outcome will be extremely poor. There is really no plan B, in my opinion.
Now, Singapore, Malaysia and Indonesia, your three favoured topics. Which one of those is the most exposed to this European impact and US impact?
The links come through at different levels, and that makes that quite a hard question to answer. Obviously, there's trade. The European growth outlook is very weak, and it's a big market for most Asian countries. But there are also financial links. Asia performs poorly if the euro currency is weak, and at the moment it is. And we're also hearing that some Asian exporters are facing tightening credit offers with counterparts in Europe as the European banking system becomes more risk averse. That's pushing them onto their own national banking systems. That's a particular problem in China. Of the three countries you mentioned, Indonesia has the best mix. It's less export dependent and its export markets tend to be other Asian countries rather than the West.
Eric, same before the break. Indonesia has the best mixed bag, as a collection of words for you, isn't it? The best mixed bag,
yeah.
As opposed to being the least perhaps vulnerable to the US, European particularly,
yeah.
Slowdown.
Well, Indonesia has scale, which is important. It means that it's credible to talk about a growing domestic market there. It has relatively low exports, and those exports are not in cyclical manufacturing sectors. And critically, its export markets, for its commodity exports especially, are other Asian countries. That would be especially useful if China stimulates its economy, because Indonesia has purchased into that.
Let's discuss next year, 2012. Let's discuss, I had before on HSBC's private banker, talked about, he didn't say it's going to happen, but he talked many times about the words global recession.
Yeah.
And the US impact, the debt, the 14 trillion debt and rising, and the European contagion and so on, and the impact on Asia. What do you see, what's still the worst forecast you have as regards the most pessimistic, or are you upbeat at CLSA?
Our central case is relatively upbeat. Asia has to some extent decoupled. There are strong domestic credit cycles in some countries, and China and India have capacity to ease policy. I'm actually not that pessimistic on the US. I think the US bottomed in the middle of this year and may even improve in the second half of 2012.
A bit of a mess.
They could break it by being too aggressive, so I'm hoping that politicians there are pragmatic. Europe, of course, is the wild card. What we all fear is a big European bank failing, causing a Lehman-style crunch in financing. I think that central banks are much more aware of the risks. That was why we saw the cuts in credit line costs that were announced earlier this week. I also think that trading companies are much more prepared. So, for example, we've heard of Singaporean companies that historically have used French credit lines negotiating with Singapore banks just in case those French banks are unable to provide that credit.
With the idea of Singapore, I must ask you, I mean, we were discussing during the commercial break that you believe that Singapore is the most vulnerable due to that trade and export story.
It has a big financial services sector and it has a very large trade sector that is already underperforming. So it is extremely vulnerable. Our forecast for Singapore next year is 2-2.5%, which is dramatically slower than this year. But quite frankly, there are a number of Asian countries that are very open and therefore very exposed. On top of Singapore, you'd add in Malaysia. On top of that, you'd add in Thailand and probably also Taiwan.
Final word, as it's a Friday, end of the week, what makes you feel relieved today?
I think what was most interesting in the last 24 hours is Draghi's testimony. It was very dovish. It was very interesting that he was talking about the ECB's inflation target being symmetrical, which means if they see a deflation risk, they can justify easing policy. And that's not just cutting rates, it's also buying government debt.
Eric Fishbrook, many thanks for joining us. Eric Fishbrook, the head of economic research at CLSA.